This is Ndugu Chancellor in the lobby of the famed Dunbar Hotel at the corner of 42nd Place and Central Avenue in Los Angeles. This hotel housed most of the famed musicians that stayed and played on the Central Avenue jazz scene in Los Angeles at clubs such as the Downbeat, the Alabama, the Last Word, and the Mimo. Tune in to our story featuring Mr. Roy Porter.
Welcome to Life Begins at 40 Plus. The composition that you just heard belongs to my guest, Roy Porter. Roy Porter is a drummer, he's a composer, and a band leader. Welcome, Roy, to 40 Plus.
Thank you, Marilyn. It's a pleasure to be here.
You were nodding approval. Yes,
yes,
yes, I am what you're saying.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Roy, you are a famous man, and many people know what you've done in the music industry, and they know that you are a famous drummer, and I don't know if so many of them know that you are also a composer, right?
Yeah. Well, not too many. Yeah, they do now, though,
mm-hmm.
because I had a million seller with the Friends of Distinction, a thing called Lonesome that you just heard.
Yes.
So that made me be known as a composer. But prior to that, I mean, I was only known as a drummer, coming along with Charlie Parker, Dexter Gordon, almost everybody in the jazz, in the bebop idiom.
Dr. Baysetter, and a very, very warm welcome to our special guests as we learn a little bit about our history of music, jazz, right here in the Los Angeles area. We have, first off, Mr. Roy Porter, who is a musician by profession, jazz, a drummer. He is now an author. What made you come out to Los Angeles?
May of 1944.
But what made you come out here? What was the catalyst that said it was time to move on and L.A. was the place?
I had been to New York and had been back there playing the Apollo Theater mm-hmm. with T-Bone Walker and Milton Larkin at 19 years old. And I got back to Colorado Springs. My mother passed.
Mm-hmm.
So I came to Los Angeles to see what was happening out here because they didn't have another place to go. And when I got out here, the music that was being played on Central Avenue was Joe Liggins and the Honey Drippers, the After Hours with Erskine Hawkins and all that kind of stuff. But I wanted to do something different because I'd heard the masters in the East doing something else.
Mm-hmm.
And I joined Howard McGee's band out here.
Mm-hmm.
He was the one that brought bebop out here before Charlie Parker came out here.
I saw Big Sid sitting back there, didn't know who he was, but I'd beaten on pots and pans trying to play two around Colorado Springs. So when I saw this dude, he's so big and great big hands, but he had so much finesse. The brush, especially the brush. Now he's one of the first dudes that I saw in person that impressed me because he had so much finesse. Now, I didn't get to meet Big Sid. I didn't say anything to him that night. I didn't get to meet Big Sid until the first time I went to New York in 43. But I used to listen to, my mother used to like Benny Goodman. I'll just tell you the way you can get it just the way you want to, if you want to put it in chronological, that's that. The first dude that impressed me, made me want to start playing drums, was Gene Krupa, which he made drums popular as far as drum solos was concerned. Ain't no getting around that. And my mother, she used to listen to Benny Goodman. She liked Benny Goodman. I like Benny Goodman too. So we understood the difference between white music and black music. So when I saw Big Sid Kettner, I'd heard Chick Webb's Liza on record, but I hadn't seen it yet, you understand? So, but for the modern drumming, at the time, what you would call modern at that time, when I saw Big Sid Kettner, I knew it was something different. Okay, Big Sid. So then when I got to New York, the first time in 43 with Milton Larkin's band, the T-Bone Walker, we played the Apollo Theater. I'm still a swing drummer, you understand? But I went down to Minton's one night and heard Klute. I never forget from Styx, man. I don't know about no New York. You understand? And,
excuse me, you say his name.
Who? Kenny Clark. I hear Clue. He's the first dude I heard drop a bomb. But see, then I became famous for this bomb dropper later on. But the point is, this dude sitting back there, you know, and something else, because me and Joe Jones were sitting at the table there in the minutes. Joe Jones was one of my, Papa Joe, one of my, I said, man, he said, what are these dudes doing? He said, Roy, I said, they're just doing something different. He said, but don't nobody know everything about drugs. And it took me years and years later on to really know what Joe Jones was talking about. That's getting ahead of my story. Clue, Monk, and I think it was Eddie Lockjaw Davis, and it might have been Oscar Pettiford was on the stand, but this is 43. So that's the band, Howard McGee. So when Howard organized his band, he was doing the thing. So he gave me, I want you to join my group. And he got me in the group. He took Teddy Evans. Teddy Evans was working with Roy Milton. He took Teddy Evans off of alto, because Teddy was playing alto with Roy Milton's band. He took Teddy Evans off of alto, put him on tenor. And he had J.D. Stanley Morgan was in the band, Frank's father. But the stuff we was playing, Frank Morgan's father wasn't able to keep up to do what we was doing. It was a new thing. Then he brought in J.D. King, because J.D. King was a saxophone player that had been with Howard and Andy Kirk's band together. And had Vernon Biddle on piano, and Robert Dingbot Kessler, a white boy, on bass. And we opened up the downbeat on 42nd and 7th. Los Angeles was a monster during those days, man. It, like, 52nd Street, I'd been there, you know. And it, I will say it is. Okay, well, nobody says, they always talk about New York and this, but New York was no better than Los Angeles in those days. On Central Avenue, this is bad. And downbeat. So Howard McGee's band was bad, man. The people had in there. And Howard was the one, I got to give Howard McGee credit. He told me, he said, man, he says, see, I like what you're doing. I said, well, I've been back there. He said, I know you. He said, I like the way you try. He said, I like the way you tried to drop your bomb. He said, but do them so you won't mess up the meter. Just do what you want to do, but just so you won't mess up the meter. Now, a lot of laymen will not understand what I say when I say the meter. I mean, keeping the time in the proper perspective where nobody will get off. So, I mean, instead of saying, my bombs would be like, but it's evident on those records first. And other drummers would be saying, da-boom. Mine would say, room. I'd make a, you know, room sound, room. Mine would explode. So Howard would say, he said, man, just do them. He said, do them. That's what he said, do them any kind of way you want, just keep the meter going. So when Bird, I did it. I should have to give Howard McGee credit for straightening me out.
Everybody else. Yeah. My publicist. Linda, come on.
You already come to the house, yeah?
Well, I used to come over here when Eric was in the band, you know, when he was in my big band. Yeah.
You had sessions, yeah? You mean, I mean, practicing or
playing
together?
Yeah, he used to have a place where he practiced, but we never rehearsed here.
No, of course not.
Big band, no, but he was a kid, you know. Mm. He was with my band, so.
Yes, he was 20 years old.
Yeah. Come on.
Coming.
name is Thierry Bruno. I am a musician and I am actually writing a book on Eric Dolphy.
Most of the young guys were interested in trying to sound like Charlie Parker. Mm. But he had his own thing. He had his own sound, his own intonation, his own phrasing. And he was one of the best readers that you want to run across in the music business, because he used to tell me, so, man, he wanted to be the first black guy in the Los Angeles Philharmonic. And when he first come in, Eric looked like a certified public, a CPA, you understand, certified public accountant. He didn't look like no musician would come in. But when he sat down there and started playing the music, he could read so good. And his tone was very, very nice. And that's the reason we kept him in the band. The young guy. The whole band was young, 1948. But Eric had that certain something that most youngsters don't have. He didn't care about drinking. He didn't care about the chicks, girls, you understand? But there's a lot of groupies around.
He didn't take any drugs?
No. Mm-hmm. We would drink, and some of the guys, we dropped pills and stuff like that. But Eric, once in a while, he might would take a drink. Eric was a nice, clean-cut young man, and he was a practice-aholic. When we get through rehearsing, instead of him going off having a ball like the rest of the guys would do or something, you know, he'd go home and practice.
In 1945, Roy was part of the first bebop band on the Los Angeles Central Avenue scene. This band was led by trumpeter Howard McGee. Playing the McGee special featured also is Teddy Edwards. This band exposed Roy to such bebop pioneers as Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker, The Bird. In 1946, Roy recorded some jazz classics with Charlie Parker. He recorded Moose to Mooch, Ornithology, A Night in Tunisia, Yardbird Suite, and the gem, Lover Man. During a jam at the Elks Auditorium, Roy was captured with Dexter Gordon and Wardell Gray. This produced the album, The Hunt. From 1948 to 1950, Roy led the Roy Porter Big Band, a band that featured Eric Dolphy and Art Farmer. Roy played in the innovative bands that played Bop City. Featuring the likes of Teddy Edwards and Dexter Gordon, this brought forth the album, The Duel. Jessica, a Porter original, here played by the Roy Porter Sound Machine. Here to do a radio interview at KJLH Radio with Jackie Stevens, Roy keys in on his next steps musically that keep him ahead of the pack. By associating himself with today's pulse of musicians, singers, and rappers, Roy is still in the musical mix.
It is a given, it is something natural, because where you were born, where you grew up, was
weird.
99.99.99%
yes,
white.
Yes, it was. I guess it was just in me, because I am black.
Mm-hmm.
But it is a given for us, the black people.
Mm-hmm. So enlist for us some of the instruments you have a command over.
Well, I was mainly a drummer. But I could always go to the piano as a child and play boogie woogies and stuff like that, but I really didn't know what I was doing. And I went off to Wiley College to study journalism, but I was good enough to get in the band playing drums. Okay, my major was journalism, and then music became my major, and journalism became my minor. That's where I made my living. But I really should have been a piano player, because I had a good feeling for piano. I composed too. So now I was pretty good on drums.
Okay, go ahead. You can pat yourself on the back. We understand. So tell me about some of the life in the early stages, entering into the jazz arena, meeting some of the greats, and it's fine here too to do some name dropping.
Oh yeah. Okay. In the book, like. My first big encounter was with, I was about 18, going on 19 after I left Wiley College. I was at Drum Boogie Chicago with T-Bone Walker. You probably heard T-Bone Walker, great blues singer. And we played, called the Chitlin' Circuit. Now, in those days in the 40s, the Chitlin' Circuit meant the black theaters, like the Regal Theater in Chicago. You go from the Regal Theater, play a weekend, and a week in each theater, to the Howard in Washington. I'm not getting them in chronological order, but the Royal in Baltimore, the Paradise in Detroit, on into the Apollo. So I was playing, I played the Apollo when I was 19. And with name dropping, I met.
That's a great way of giving back, as they say. Let me get your opinion, bringing it all the way up to today. What do you think about rap music?
Well, frankly speaking, some of it, I like some of it. The only ones that I don't like is when they denigrate my black woman or their self. Mm-hmm. Some of it is very, very positive because they have taken some of my music that I had from the sound machine that I had in the 70s. I had the first sound machine before the Miami sound machine, a group called the Roy Porter sound machine, that recorded tunes in the 70s. So recently, some of the guys that you saw outside and the homies sitting in there now are young musicians that's off into the new thing. They've taken some of my music and put rap lyrics to it, and I feel honored. Mm-hmm. As long as they don't denigrate my black woman or the black man or themselves, you got to love yourself before you love anybody. That's something I don't like about some of the time. Thank you.
Having helped pioneer the bebop music in Los Angeles, Roy is pioneering new musical frontiers, both for himself and others around him. He has been a major influence on the LA scene, not only as a drummer and composer, but also as a living testament of what the Los Angeles jazz scene was all about, both in the past, but also the present, as well as the future. There are few legends left to tell the story as Roy can. Pictured here is Roy along with Wallace Huff, a trombonist with the Roy Porter sound machine.
And I'm 69 years old too. It's me to the death. I'm 67 years old. You look out for thank you. So you know what I'm saying?
I think
so,
you're very pleased to have you there.
Yeah.
I, and the public would be too, because we all listen to this thing.
So see, the rappers want me, she said, you ought to go and do it too. The rappers want me to sing another group called Freestyle something. Want me to sing and do a song on their rap record. I'm like, I'll do it, man. I'll do it. Why not?
Yeah, why not?
Yeah. Look just as good as they do.
Hey, right? Rap, most of them.
Yeah, I can do something.
Roy's big band featured Eric Dolphy, Art Farmer, Jimmy Nepper, Hadley Kalaman, Clifford Solomon, Joe Howard, Addison Farmer, Demita Joe, Leroy Sweet Pea Robinson, Clyde Dunn, Danny Horton, Alvy Kidd, Benny White, Robert Ross, Eddie Preston, Roger Alderson, Wilbur Brown, William Wiggy Wigington, and William Boogie Daniels, with vocalist Paul Sparks.
This is Bill Brannon, host of the early Sunday morning show, Jazz at Sunup, happily informing you that you're listening to dynamic young Scott Conley on Jazz Radio, FM 88, KLON, Long Beach.
Let's tune in to Roy during an interview with Dale Cook.
All right, now if you want something after, now you're playing Howard McGee that one. Then you're playing Howard, you're playing Andy Kirk and Howard McGee special by Howard McGee. Andy Kirk first and then Howard.
See, that's why I wanted to play the Andy Kirk first.
Okay.
But it doesn't make any difference, right?
All right, now the next one, that's 45. Now the next thing you should do is 46. You jump on over to the thing that did with Bird.
Well,
unless...
But we're going to go back to 45. We're going to play some more of this stuff. So you got Rock Around the Clock.
Well, do you pick?
And they'll appreciate knowing that.
But you got to go to something else before we can get back to
Rock. Yeah, right, right.
On another album.
What can you suggest?
On another album.
Central Avenue Breakdown?
You can. Let's see.
What year was that, 45?
Oh, this is 20 minutes after 12. Reflections is the name of the LP. Dave on piano, Bill Smith clarinet, Chris Brubeck on electric bass, and...
I think they got T-A-Y-L-O-R, which is Taylor, but I'm pretty sure her name was Pearl Trailer.
Yeah, that's what it has, T-R-E-Y-L-O-R.
Does it?
Yeah,
okay,
Trailer.
I'm correct.
Howard McGee on the trumpet, Teddy Edwards, and James D. King on the tenor sax.
Right.
Vernon Biddy on the piano.
Biddle,
yeah, right, okay. And Bob Kesterson on the bass, and Roy, you're on the drums.
Right.
You know, this, we kind of selected that for a reason, because a lot of people talk about jazz being this and jazz being that. But, you know, you always had a blues singer with the greatest of groups, right?
That's right.
To try to cover that whole audience in the auditorium.
Right,
you know?
Right.
Okay, let's talk about this next tune. We've got Out of Nowhere. You remember that particular date?
That's the date with Duke Brooks on piano.
Yeah, right.
Art Farmer on bass.
Oh, Addison, yeah.
Addison Farmer on bass, mm-hmm. Myself and Teddy, and I think Benny Bailey
on the trumpet.
It features Benny Bailey on Out of Nowhere, which is a ballad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we'll get back to that in just a second, but right now we'd better remind you that this is Jazz Radio, FM 88, KLON Long Beach. I'm Del Cook, and my special in-studio guest is Roy Porter. Okay, here we go with Out of Nowhere.
Other drummer contemporaries of Roy's in L.A. were Billy Higgins, Chico Hamilton, and Lawrence Marble. Here is Roy with the legendary Billy Higgins. As a composer, Roy has been responsible for some timeless gems. During a tribute to Roy at the Watchtowers Jazz Festival in 1986, the Horace Tapscott Orchestra played Jessica. Featured on trombone is George Bohannon.
Welcome to Jazz in Review. Today we'll be talking to three distinguished Los Angeles-based musicians who can give us the history of Central Avenue, and our guests are experts. Marshall Royal, saxophonist extraordinaire, raised in Los Angeles, known in jazz circles as a dominant voice of the bassy sound, and largely responsible for organizing the second big bassy band of 1951. Red Callender, bassist, tuba player, composer, arranger, jazz educator, co-author of his current autobiography, Unfinished Dream, and Roy Porter, drummer, composer, arranger, band leader, and Central Avenue historian. Did Central Avenue proliferate with the war? Did that bring more and more clubs and catering to soldiers and to...
Well, I would say it did. Because up to before the war started in all of the Los Angeles area, there were only about 200,000 blacks. And a lot of migration took place, and well, the rest is history.
Yeah.
I think that's about the time that Roy Porter.
Yeah, I was thinking about when you come in, all sorts of things are happening. There's great changes and great movements in music. The bebop era has arrived. Howard McGee has come here earlier with Coleman Hawkins,
right.
And has stayed.
Right.
Tell me a little bit about that period, because you come in at a very active time.
Yeah,
right?
First of all, I'm one of the Rocky Mountain boys from Colorado, you understand? Mm-hmm. And I had been to New York with Milton Larkin's band, with T-Bone Walker, played the Apollo Theater. And then I went into the service to Keesler Field, Mississippi, which was the Air Force in Biloxi. And then after I was discharged in February of 1944, I came out here to Los Angeles via Colorado Springs, Colorado. When I got out here, May of 1944, I call it the musical revolution was going on. Because I'd been back to New York and I'd seen people like Thelonious Monk, Kenny Clark, Kloop they call him, Diz, Dizzy Gillespie, Freddie Webster, Fats Navarro, all those people. And I said, well, there's something different. So when I got to the coast out here, that wasn't really happening. The two drummers of note, speaking from a drum point at the time, was Oscar Bradley and Forrest Chico Hammond. But I started working with Teddy Bunn, and I worked with Benny Carter down at Diane's on 8th Street near Alvarado. And Howard McGee wanted me. Well, that changed the whole ball game for me with Howard, because he was doing the thing I call the thing something new. Which is a drummer dropping bomb, da-ka-boom, and I wouldn't use my bass drum, so it was kind of that was during the period of revolution in music. So now we get down to the heavy stuff. Charlie Parker came out here in 1945. We were at the Streets of Paris, which is on Hollywood Boulevard, down the street from Las Palmas. Bird came into the Streets of Paris. Diz came out here and brought with him Charlie Parker, Ray Brown, Stan Levy, Milt Jackson, and Al Haig. So the first and second night they were here, they didn't open right there. Bird came in the Streets of Paris, and that's the first time I met Charlie Parker. So he liked what I was doing, I guess. Consequently, on the first recording session that Bird met out here for Dial, I was on. Night Too Easy, Ornithology, Moose to Moose Yard, Bird Suite. The second session I was on, Lover Man, which is, I call this the most catastrophic session in history, because Bird was sick, Charlie Parker was sick that night. Everybody knows that he had a problem. We did Lover Man, The Gypsy, Max Making Wax, Bebop. But Bird didn't want those released, but they were released, and they're still classic. After that episode tonight, Howard went back to New York in 47. In 48, I went back to New York with Dexter Gordon to play the Three Deuces.